So, Overwatch's new update kinda fucked this video in the ass. In the original script, I was mostly going to focus on the negatives and why the game failed to grab me as much as I wish it did. But then Overwatch dropped a huge update, and for me, it marked a major shift not only in Overwatch's development, but the online gaming scene as a whole. While I still have plenty of issues that I doubt can really be fixed, I suddenly have a lot more faith in the game than I did previously. So, bearing that in mind, here's my hastily rewritten video. Damn it, Jeff. Now, although I do really enjoy this game, this is still mostly a constructive critique, so we'll be focusing on things that need tweaking. Overwatch has four main issues I'll be discussing, but I think it's important to note that the recent update has done a pretty good job in addressing two of them. The core issues are: 1. It's high tension social situations. In other words, the infamous toxicity of the community. 2. Overemphasis on the team fight, resulting in repetitive gameplay. 3. Loot boxes. Just loot boxes. And 4, quantity over quality. In other words, there's too many goddamn characters to balance. So, without further ado, let's dive headfirst into the salt mines and talk about the toxicity. Every single shooter is going to contain toxic assholes. That doesn't mean it's something we should blindly accept, and there's really no excuse for this sort of behavior regardless of context. But it's an inevitability of online animid and that. However, there are two factors that lead to an increased likelihood of douchebaggery in this game in particular: popularity and team size. The popularity issue is pretty obvious. I believe it was the historic American poet Robert Frost who coined the phrase, "The bigger a fandom is, the more assholes it will contain." The bigger pool of a people a fandom draws from, the more toxic people are going to make themselves known. And while they might be a vocal minority, they can be very, very vocal. And also, there can be a lot of them, even if it is a minority. As a side note, I'd like to point out something I think a lot of people don't consciously notice or think about. You see, I have a lot, and I do mean a lot of friends who are passionately into video games. Friends from every background, creed, race, gender, and orientation. And I can't help but notice that among my crew, only the straight white guys seem to be able to enjoy online shooters, at least if they use their mic. Even if my other friends enjoy single-player shooters, they can't seem to get invested in the multiplayer ones. I can't imagine why. I was going to put some examples of why they feel this way here, but honestly, no. Yes, I'm sure plenty of you know exceptions to this, but to deny the problem here is literally insane. Please don't be that guy who denies a lived experience of literally millions of players just because you haven't met someone with a story like this. This issue is exacerbated in Overwatch due to its massive player pool, but regardless of the context and whatever excuses people have, it's still unacceptable. If anything, screaming homophobic slurs at someone while you're playing as a lesbian displays a special lack of self-awareness that I may never fully comprehend. But just bear in mind that showing people the bare minimum of respect and understanding doesn't make you an oversensitive pussy so much as a functional adult with the mental faculty to process that maybe someone doesn't particularly want to be dehumanized and belittled while they're enjoying their hobby. Just putting it out there. And trust me when I say that reporting and muting doesn't really do much to alleviate the problem. Avoiding voice communications as a rule restricts a lot of strategic and social aspects of games like this, and the people who get harassed are just gonna keep getting harassed by new people anyway most of the time. When you see people act like this, call them out. If they're a streamer, call them out publicly. Naming and shaming has proven to be a pretty effective strategy for assholes like this. If you care about the gaming community, call out people who are ruining other people's fun for no reason. If you think that's a controversial statement, then suck the darkest part of my white ass. I don't fucking know. But there's another side to the caustic coin of the community, and it actually revolves around a particular aspect of the game's design itself. In Overwatch, you have a relatively small amount of players in a match, 6 people total on each team. That's it. And I think peeps tend to underestimate how influential that small team size really is. Let me put it like this. In Battlefield, your actions represent about 3% of the team's performance. In TF2, 8%. But in Overwatch, your actions represent about 17%. Double the importance compared to TF2, and double the pressure to do well. Some people thrive under that pressure, and some people just don't give a shit and play for pure fun. But that pressure still results in some heightened tension in matches. And it's a big reason why people tend to get tilted pretty easily in games with low team sizes. Now, I don't want to put DF2 on some kind of pedestal, it has more than its fair share of balancing issues, shout out to Pyro, but when it comes to team size, I think Valve struck a perfect happy medium for casual play. In TF2, one incredibly good player will make a big difference, but they won't usually single-handedly win a game. Unless they're Banny or some shit, but he's not even human, so he doesn't count. But at the same time, if you're new, making a lot of mistakes or trying a new strategy you haven't mastered yet, or even just goofing off, no one's really gonna notice in TF2. You're not going to single-handedly lose the game. It's designed to make you feel like you can make a difference without making you feel super guilty or become a target of some tilted asshole when you fuck up. Obviously, high tension and harassment still happens in every game, and it's unacceptable in any context. But in Overwatch, I can't help but feel that the game's structure helps to exacerbate this problem. If your team isn't doing well, it can be tempting to foist the blame onto one particular weak link, or just blame anyone besides yourself. This is the typical starting point of many of Overwatch's more toxic moments. And since the game's team size is clearly not going to change outside of arcade modes, this can result in a lot of tense situations. That all being said, Blizzard's recent endorsement system seems like a really good step in the right direction. It effectively amounts to a pat on the back that might help people get loot boxes somewhere down the line, but it's mostly just a way to make other players feel nice for being nice. And believe it or not, after playing with it for a while, it really seemingly has made a difference in the community already. It's made the game more enjoyable. So, major props to Blizzard for this update. The endorsement system is a brilliant idea. In an era where game developers shrug off their toxic communities as an inevitability they can't do anything about, they stepped up and took direct action. And given the increase in teamwork and positivity that I've noticed, it's actually working pretty damn well. Is it gonna fix all the problems in the community? No. But it does incentivize not being a dick, and that's definitely a tremendous step in the right direction. Now, another issue, but a rather straightforward one, is the emphasis on the team fight. This is a very subjective topic, but I still want to bring it up. In Overwatch, everything revolves around getting every player on the server together for a massive teamfight, at least at mid to high levels of play. You're either at the front line of a teamfight, or you support someone else in the teamfight. Even flank characters are usually just approaching the teamfight from a different angle. Very rarely will a player be focused on doing something besides preparing or actively participating in a big fight with 8 to 12 players. This is because Overwatch's maps are fairly simple, compact, and straightforward, and the small team sizes mean it's hard for a team to realistically multitask. In a lot of other games, the maps are larger, with more substantial flank routes and bigger player counts, not to mention the fact that some players can actually influence how spawning works with mechanics like squad spawns in Battlefield or teleporters in TF2. This allows for maps to have what I like to call side objectives. Areas like an easily defended hallway, a side building, a source of health and ammo packs, a good spot to set up a temporary base with supportive tools, etc. With larger team sizes, longer match times, and bigger maps, you tend to get a large variety of these side objectives. Desperate fights to control a valuable room with health packs, or an entire squad protecting a powerful flank route. in my experience, a match of Overwatch tends to lack this sort of complexity and variability, thus making games a bit more repetitive unless you just start trying various different characters. The wide variety of playstyles the heroes provide in Overwatch helps combat the monotony, for sure. But I've noticed that most of the game's maps get kinda predictable pretty quickly. Even on some of TF2 or Battlefield's lesser maps, the sheer variety of side objectives, larger player count, and the more intricate level design at least keeps things interesting. Also, side note, I don't want to make it look like I'm putting Battlefield on a pedestal, because it's a very flawed series in terms of balance and level design. I vastly prefer Overwatch overall. I'm just saying that things are rarely boring in Battlefield so much as frustrating. What the fuck was I supposed to do about that? I think this issue can be alleviated with the addition of more intricate maps like the recent Blizzard World. And although this might be kind of insane, I wouldn't mind Blizzard experimenting with 9v9, or maybe 8v8. I wouldn't expect it to work in competitive, but it would be a nice thing to try out. Unfortunately, this might cause performance issues because Blizzard loves their particle effects, but I'd still like to see them at least experiment with a concept. Totally admit it might be a terrible idea, just really curious how it would work. And the third major issue is... loot boxes. That's all, just loot boxes. And to conclude, issue number four... okay, fine. Look, mobile games started the idea of microtransactions. Then TF2 got the ball rolling in mainstream gaming, and then Overwatch took that ball and turned it into a red giant on the verge of nuclear detonation. Along with Valve, Blizzard is one of the companies most responsible for the legalized gambling loophole shitstorm that is loot boxes. Once you've bought the game, you effectively have one way of supporting it financially. Gambling. You can't buy a specific skin you want, you have to grind and gamble. You can't buy a specific emote, you have to grind and gamble. Yes, you can get credits to purchase things directly, but once again, it's a total gamble whether or not you get any credits to begin with. You can't purchase credits. You can only purchase another chance to gamble for credits. It's a shitty, exploitative, consumer-hostile way of making money. Blizzard hasn't even considered making skins available to purchase directly, and that doesn't surprise me, because I'm sure the gambling approach makes them much more money in the long run. What does surprise me is that the community doesn't seem to think this is all that big of a deal. Overwatch has started, or at least reinforced, a terrible trend. And regardless of how well Overwatch does in the future, loot boxes may just be the game's most enduring legacy. And that is honestly a depressing thought. Anyway, for real, the final issue, but another thing that Blizzard has recently addressed to some extent. Quantity over quality in terms of character design. I'm noticing a bit of a problem with some recently added Overwatch heroes, and I'm hoping it's not going to become a trend. Most of the new characters added to the game are, at the very least, unique. They might not be properly balanced or fulfill a necessary role, but at least their mechanics and design stand out in comparison to the previously existing characters. But then we get heroes like Orisa and Brigitte. Orisa is as effective as she is downright adorable, so I don't want to hate on her too much. I do like this character, but it's pretty obvious that Blizzard took a lot of shortcuts in her development. Almost every ability she has is essentially a modified version of something another hero can do. She has a shield that's basically the fusion of Winston and Reinhardt's shield. She has a magnet ball that's like a weak version of Zarya's ult. She has a rapid-fire minigun with a widespread similar to D.Va's primary fire. And her ultimate is basically a more powerful version of one of Mercy's normal abilities. She's a perfectly functional character and is probably my favorite tank in the game. Plus, she has a pretty lovable personality, which is more than I can say for most of this cast, but it's undeniable that she wasn't very labor-intensive to design, and she doesn't really offer much in the way of a new unique playstyle. She's basically here to finally offer an alternative to Reinhardt so teams don't have to literally run him in practically every game. It's a design that felt a bit lazy to me, but that didn't prepare me for the most recent addition, Brigit. This is a character that literally fills the role of, like, four different heroes. She has a personal Rhine shield, so she can kinda tank, a close-range stun, a long-range knockback, a healing aura similar to Lucio, and she can provide burst heals and armor like a combination of Anna and Torbjorn. And there isn't a single one of these abilities that even vaguely requires any skill or experience from the player to pull off. Whenever I play Brigit, even if I'm half asleep, I get multiple golds every time. She's a DPS, tank, healer, hybrid. All of her abilities are copied from other characters, she has the personality of a hunk of plastic, and her backstory reads like a fanfic. She's Reinhardt's squire. Whatever the fuck that means in Overwatch's time period. And Torbjorn's daughter. That's it. That's kind of a combination of two previously existing characters. That's all there is to Brigit. I literally cannot name a single personality trait of this character, and her voice lines make it feel like Blizzard doesn't know anything about her personality either. Then there's the fact that she honestly looks like they slightly altered Mercy's face model. Combine this with the imbalance, the lazy reused abilities, and the fact that she doesn't really fulfill a role that was missing, it feels like Brigit was rushed out the door just so Blizzard can say they made a new wife character. New character, that's what I was going to say. I understand that Blizzard wants to maintain interest in the game by creating new playable heroes. But even back when the game's business model was first announced, I always thought this was a terrible idea. The game shipped with 21 playable characters. That's already quite a few playstyles and kits to balance and design in a fun way. And appropriately, a lot of the cast is either extremely underused or overused due to the lack of balance. Not to mention that many of these heroes are very undeveloped from a writing perspective. And yet they keep adding more heroes on top of that as opposed to focusing on the problems of the existing cast. I know I'm playing favorites yet again, but the most enduring character-focused shooter of all time is Team Fortress 2, with a mere 9 characters. And in spite of having a completely nonsensical, comedy-focused narrative that effectively retcons itself every few years, this game has produced 9 of the most memorable personalities and playstyles that the medium has ever seen. And while the game isn't perfectly balanced, its focused design makes each character not only more complex and enjoyable, but also more well-balanced and memorable. If you haven't even played TF2, you can still probably describe the personality of this guy just by glimpsing at him for about 3 seconds. Meanwhile, I have several hours on Pharah, and I frequently forget her existence. Blizzard is generally really good at creating fictional worlds, and really mediocre at telling engaging stories in those worlds. I don't think Overwatch is ever really going to wow me with character development, but I hope the team eventually slows down and focuses on fleshing out the existing cast rather than throwing more cooks in the already very crowded kitchen. Unfortunately, due to the lack of foresight on part of Blizzard, there's another issue that can, ironically, only be fixed by adding more characters. Let me explain. Look at this screen. You noticing a bit of a problem? One job has all the variety in the world, and the other two jobs are severely lacking. Lucio is one of the most fun characters I've ever played in any game, but even I get tired of playing the same 3 main healers over and over again. Hell, if I'm being honest, Lucio and Anna are the only main healers that I can really even tolerate, because Mercy's just a less strategically complex version of Medic from TF2. Like, I don't know, why wouldn't I just go play that? While there will always be poor team compositions in games like this, and people who just want to fuck off and play sniper, the lack of variety for tanks and supports isn't exactly helping the issue. It makes these vital roles much more repetitive to play. And while we're on the subject of character balance, there's one last thing I want to address. A lot of heroes are just too mechanically simple. Overwatch tries to cater to casual players by making characters that are very simple and easy to use, but still quite effective. Characters like Symetra, Brigit, and Reinhardt don't really take a lot of skill or experience to pull off well, and none of them have a particularly high skill ceiling either. Yet they're all powerful enough to make a difference. These characters can be used by newer players to give them a fighting chance against more experienced players, so it doesn't feel like newbies get curb stomped all the time. This isn't me projecting or just insulting the more simplistic characters, I feel this was a very conscious design choice from Blizzard. And it's a choice I don't really agree with. On the one hand, it makes Overwatch much more accessible than other, more competitive and technical shooters like TF2 or the various Quake games. But the downside, for me at least, is the lack of depth. It's hard to get invested in improving at most of these characters when their mechanics are so shallow and simplistic. Beyond slightly better aim, communication, and timing, how much difference is there really between a 10-hour Reinhardt and a 100-hour Reinhardt? But there's a much bigger consequence of these simplistic characters. It harms the sense of self-improvement that makes competitive games appealing. Pre-patch Symetra, Moira, and Mei are perhaps the greatest examples of characters that are frustrating to die against. When I die to Soldier 76, I feel like I could have changed my positioning, improved my dodging, or just killed him faster. Against Mei, I feel like the fight was decided before it even began. What can the enemy reasonably do against this? Or this? Not much. In situations like this, skill, experience, strategy, and timing all go out the window. And if that doesn't bother you, or you want to come up with increasingly complex excuses for things this completely immobilized player did wrong, then cool, I guess. I guess we're just not supposed to exist within 10 yards of a Mei. But for me personally, I like the feeling of constant improvement that comes with games like this. And when I die to something that freezes me in my tracks just for existing in the same plane of reality as an enemy or rounding a corner at the wrong time, it starts to feel like my skills and efforts don't really matter much. I'm sure plenty of people will dismiss these complaints as salt, but it's just really genuine disappointment that the game is designed this way. There are reasons for it being designed like this, but for me, nothing really justifies the sacrifice. If I die in a game like this, I want to feel like it's my fault. And very, very frequently in Overwatch, it simply doesn't. Thankfully, the recent update has made it clear that Blizzard is at least aware of the various issues. The company is willing to make major changes in the design of its heroes in order to make the game more balanced, engaging, and rewarding. Symetra has been subject to complaint for 2 full years. But after various reworks, they finally completely redesigned her entire kit to reward skill and strategy as opposed to holding down a mouse button and jumping in random directions. Yes, she still definitely needs some tweaking and rebalancing, but the fact that they're willing to make such drastic changes is actually kind of encouraging to me. The fact that they're willing to make this massive change to the game's balance gives me hope that Overwatch might actually maintain my interest over the years. On that note, please, God, do something about Mei. Thank you. Overall, I really like Overwatch. I want to see it continue to improve. And I think listening to these criticisms will result in a more complex, engaging, and less predictable game overall. A game that can stand the test of time. And given some of the team's recent decisions, I can honestly say, I'm cautiously optimistic about the future of Overwatch. Oh, and a side note, this is the new hero they recently revealed. What the fuck is wrong with these people?